will of God.
Yes.
Amen. I want to just read a couple of more scriptures that fall under the same category. Romans 6:13, it says, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Romans 6:13 says, know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom you obey. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death, or of obedience unto righteousness. Now, those scriptures say very plainly that sanctification and holiness has to do with the control of the physical body. Sanctification basically is what you do with your body. It's all about bringing your body in subjection to your new recreated spirit. And actually, the renewing of the mind is actually when you have yielded your members as instruments of righteousness of God and bring them in subjection to your new recreated human spirit, where your spirit gains the ascendancy over your body. This is basically what the renewing of the mind is. Okay, let me just share this, just give you an illustration. There are a few more scriptures I want to read. The fact is, I believe everybody knows here that the enemy, the battleground with Satan, is in the realm of the mind. Everybody knows that. All of the attacks and the temptations and the enticements and whatever Satan is going to wage against the believer, that warfare is always waged in the realm of the mind. Everybody understand that? Okay, because the enemy has established a very close relationship with your mind, and it's an area that the enemy can come and go at will, and he doesn't have to really ask you, can I come in and get you to think on what I'm going to present to you? He has access, free access to your what? Mind. All right, so I'm going to clarify that, but we can gain the ascendancy, and we can do something about the things that the devil brings to our minds. Is that right?
Yes.
You can't keep birds from flying over your head, but you can keep a bird from making a nest in your hair. Is that right?
Yes.
Everybody get that?
Yes.
Okay, so I just want you to understand that whether you win the battle over your flesh, over your members, is going to be the strength in your human spirit that caused your mind to be able to resist whatever temptation that the enemy brings to your mind. You have to get to the point where when the enemy brings temptation and entices you to get your body involved. See, most sins are going to emanate in the realm of your body. Your members are going to actually carry it out. Your members are the ones that's going to what? That's going to respond to whatever the devil presents to your what? Mind. He has all of these floating ideas and thoughts. See, there are three sources, and sometimes maybe we're not aware of where our thoughts come from. Our thoughts will either come from God. They will either come from God or from who? Satan, or they will come from what? Ourselves. You can think of stuff. You can imagine things, right?
Yeah.
All right, so it's going to come from either from inside of you. You're going to think some things up. Maybe the devil doesn't have anything to do with that. All right, then some thoughts will come from God, right? And then some thoughts comes from what? Satan. Now, I have this thing, usually early in the morning, the Lord will speak to me on the inside, and I get a certain feel about certain things, and I know what direction I need to go. For instance, if I know if I'm thinking about trying to decide whether I want to go to North Carolina, whether I want to go to Mount Pleasant, whether I want to do this, I want to do that, the Lord will begin to deal with me, and there's a long feeling, what you call it, federally, like, it's a, that certain feeling you get on the inside, it's a real good feeling you get on the inside, like the green light comes on and not the red light. It gives you a direction. This is the path. This is what you're supposed to do. This is what you are to teach. This is what you're to do when you get there. This is the word you need. Amen. Whenever I follow that inner voice and that spirit that wakes me up, usually around 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, I never go wrong. That's the man on the inside. That's the spirit man on the inside. God reveals himself through our what? Spirit on the inside of us. And you can know the voice of God. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. So when these thoughts come, and we know that they come from within, or they come from God or the Holy Spirit, from within many times would be from our human spirit. And sometimes God will what? Speak through our human spirit. And then sometimes these things will come just from our fleshly, you know, impression on the inside. Sometimes we can think of things from the flesh and they're not of God. But we have to be able to discern the source of the thoughts that we're thinking and the source of all of the information that's being presented to us on the screen of our imagination. Amen. And what I'm saying is that whatever things present to the screen of your imagination, your members are going to be involved. Your members, your eyes, your ears, your hands, your feet. Because if you act on what Satan brings on the screen of your imagination, if you act on that, then it's going to what? It's going to cause you to what? Be led astray. It's going to cause you to be distracted. So therefore, you have to have control of the things you hear. You got to have what? Control of your members. Right? Things you see. And there are several scriptures that lets us know, okay, here's some scriptures I think I read before that tells about how most sins that people get involved with originate, and, you know, of course they originate in the mind, but it's the members that what get involved with things that you see in the mind that Satan puts on that screen to cause that thing which Satan presents to becomes what? Amen, becomes a sin. Bible says man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own what? Lust and in what? Enticed. That comes on the screen of your imagination. All of those enticements, Satan said, you want to do this? And you say, when you look at it, no. Want to do this? No. Then he just keeps on going until what? He finds something that you will what? Bite. And you bite the bait at some point. But when you bite the bait, you take action on the thing that the enemy is what? Presenting. And the action you take, you're either going to what? Fulfill whatever Satan presents by what? By one of the members of your body. Your hands, you're going to go there and get that thing or do that. Commit that act. But it's going to involve carrying out whatever Satan is presenting is going to involve your physical body. How many can say amen?
Amen?
So it's good to be able to understand that your physical bodies, your members, need to be under the control and the power of your what? Of your spirit. Amen. The word of God got to gain the ascendancy. The power of God got to gain the ascendancy. So when the enticement comes, amen, you will say what? No. You will not let your body amen, lead you astray, because most sins that will be carried out will be through some member of your body. Okay, like how many, amen, stopped smoking several years ago? How many still smoke? Nobody. Okay. Now, that temptation will come to you and be presented to you, and you have to what? You have to take action.
That's right.
To what? To get involved in what? Smoking.
That's right.
And that means that you have to what? You have to bite the bait and say, yeah, I'm going to get up and I'm going to go get me some cigarettes. That involves your what? Your feet? Right? Involves your what? Your hands? Your eyes? Your body, right? It involves your body. All right, now, that's the reason why the Bible says, Psalms 101, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. So as much as you can, if you can keep your members under control, I will set no wicked thing before my eyes. Do you believe that you can avoid a whole lot of temptations and seduction from the enemy if you could, amen, keep your eyes on things which are wholesome?
Amen.
Amen. So this is what sanctification is all about. The control of your what? Your members. If you know on television there are things that are unwholesome, you're not to what? You're not to what? You're not to watch that. So that involves your eyes. Now, there's nothing wrong with the television per se, but if you feed on things, if you let your eyes, amen, focus on things that can plant seeds in your spirit that could lead you astray, or that could absolutely take the ascendancy of your, I mean, will cause your spirit, which is supposed to be in control, which helps you, which causes your spirit to lose control over your what? Over your body, then you're to what? Avoid that. So sanctification is all about, amen, what are you doing with your what? Physical members, your body. Controlling your what? Physical members, your body. Amen. Praise God. So we call that separation from evil influences. The Bible says the eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. Watch that. Ecclesiastes 1:8. The eye is not satisfied with seeing. Alright, when the eye began to see things that are enticing, the eye's not going to be what? Satisfied with just seeing. You just want to what? See more. See a little bit more. And then the eye is going to what? Cause to bring some other memory into the what? Into play until the fleshly desire is what? Is satisfied. Alright? The hearing thing too. How many can hear things? Hear things that you don't need to be hearing. That's the reason why we don't need to be around people that talk a lot of vanity. People that gossip and people that talk about all of these bad, negative activities that they're doing. Because that can what? Cause you to be what? Drawn into sin. See, your members are the things that draw you into what? Sin. It's the members. It's mostly the members of your body that causes you to get involved in what? In sinful things. So we used to sing this song, be careful, little eyes, what you see. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. For the what? Far up above. Looking down. Be careful, little eyes, what you see. So a whole lot of sin could be avoided or aborted if you had control the things that you what? Looked at. Your eyes. Amen. Y'all ain't saying amen.
Amen.
Now, I don't like to view a whole lot of worldly things. And I don't like to go to too many movies because it's a whole lot of things that can get your mind. Sometimes I have gone, y'all are deeper than I am, I've gone to some of these movies that y'all really like. And I heard all these vulgar words, and when I get home, and sometimes I'm down on my knees, some of those vulgar words might just pop up. But that's what happens. You're yelling a little deeper than I am. So you're better off to what? To avoid as much evil as you what? Can, because it gives the devil less to what? Work with. You have to guard your what? Mind. You have to guard Amen. And you have to what? Amen. God, your members. You have to what? Amen. Be on top of what your members get involved with. Your eyes are getting what? Involved with. Amen. How many of you say amen?
Amen.
Now, all of these scriptures, here's another scripture, Proverbs 4:21 says, "Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established." Ponder the path of your feet. In Proverbs 4:20, "Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all of thy ways be established. Turn not to the right," that's the 27th verse, "nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil." Now, how many know, amen, not only are your eyes involved, your ears are involved in sin, but sometimes your feet can be involved.
That's right.
Anybody can understand how your feet can be involved in sin? All right. How can your feet be involved in sin? All right. Who did I say I took you to the wrong place? All right. Your mind tells you what? Go to that wrong place. All right. What are you using? Your eyes? You trying to what? Find what a place is? Right? And your ears are what? Open, because you want to make sure when you get to the wrong place that you won't have a run-in with the other guy and the other woman. So you're watching, listening. Go to the door. See if anybody in there. Now, all of this involves your what? Your members. All that could have been avoided when that thought came to you and you just said what? No. But your spirit has to be strong enough to tell your body no. Because in most cases, your body rules everything. Your mind and your spirit. In many cases, it does. That's the reason why the Bible says don't yield. You have a body. You have a power to what? Control your members. Is that right? And the Bible says what? I beseech ye by the mercies of God that ye present your what? Your members, a what? Living sacrifice. What? Holy, whatever? Acceptable unto God, which is your what? And be not what? Be not conformed to this world. But be ye what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind. See, the renewing of your mind is that when you feed your spirit the word, feed on the word, you pray in the spirit, and you do all of the things that God tells you to do, and you begin to get what's strong. And I guarantee you this, once you really begin to pray and seek the Lord, and you get devotion readings, and feed on the word, and really begin to sow into other people's lives, what happens is that your spirit really begins to what? Grow and get strong. And you will be surprised of how your mind can come to the point where you will very rarely have a negative thought that even what? Comes by, period. Because your mind, scripture says, he'll keep you in what? Perfect peace. See, when your mind is not girded with the truth, see, there are certain things that you can do to strengthen your mind, and very rarely you will ever have a negative thought, because your mind is going to be on that person that you are. You helped and you prayed for, you talked with, you ministered to, you, amen, you get something wonderful for. And my mind will just be on this all the time. And sometimes I just don't hardly have any, go by a whole day almost. And if Satan does bring something in the midst of the times that I'm thinking on things that are, what, like it says, think on things which are lovely, things that are what? Pure, things that are what? Of a good report, things that are just and all of that. And most times, you will reflect. See, if you feed on the word of God early in the morning, most times, when you're not focusing on your responsibilities or duties, most times your mind will revert back to whatever you read, or whatever you prayed about, or whatever you focused on that morning in devotion. Your mind has something to what? Fall back on and to reflect on. Is that right? That's the reason why you can spend a lot of your time just singing the spirit. The Lord God is a sun and shield, He gives grace and glory. No good thing will He withhold from them that walk uprightly. Praise the Lord. Amen. So you can actually fill yourself with the Word and reflect on the Word, read the Word, sing the Word, and make melody in your heart with the Word until your mind will be almost totally occupied. Anytime you're not reflecting on whatever your duties or routine or demanding that you do, your mind will always go back to that. That's the reason why you need to what? Feed on the Word, feed on the Word, feed on the Word. And I wish, how many can I get you to join the choir? How many would like to join the choir? I mean, singing in the Spirit, that's what I mean. Singing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs and making a melody. How many want to join that choir?
She waited
for me to clarify that. She thought I was talking about Brother Dean's group. She looked at me like this. Aware that there's going to be a whole lot of things that they're going to be confronted in school.
Yes.
If you ain't reading your Bible, if you're not in prayer, we need to make sure that y'all learn how to pray in the Spirit and how to read your Bible. How many of y'all have Bibles? Okay. Now that's the only way you're going to prevent your life from being what God wants it to be. The only way you're going to prevent your life to be what God wants it to be is that you're going to have to fill your mind and your heart with the Word of God. Amen. So that the Word of God and prayer and that anointing and that spiritual strength in you will act absolutely when you'll, because your friends, most of them are not saved. They're not in spirit-filled churches, and they're around people that have lives that are far from being what God wants it to be. And you're going to be tempted. All these thoughts are going to come to you. Whatever your friends are talking about, they're doing, whatever they're watching, whatever they're doing on the internet and all that, you're going to be what? You're going to be drawn into all of that, and your life is going to go what? Downhill. And your spirit going to be strong. Amen. Amen. It's going to be what? Strong. In order for you to be able to resist, the Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not what? Carnal, but they are what? Mighty through God. Your mind is going to be bombarded with what? Thoughts all day long. Amen. But the more you feed on the Word and pray and do things that will build you up spiritually, the less bombardment, the less enticements and temptations you will have. Amen. That will be coming to your mind. And even if they do, you will have the strength on the inside to say what? No.
Amen.
See, the weapons of our warfare are not what? Condom, but they're mighty through God in the what? Pulling down of what? Stronghold. Casting down. See, when those imaginations come, when those thoughts, when Satan bring those temptations across the strength of your imagination, you are able to say what? No. Don't let Satan get your members involved in carrying out whatever enticements or allurements that he's what? Trying to present to your mind. If you get your what? Eyes involved in it, go to that site. See, all these temptations first originate in the mind. Then you have to use your what? Members. Your eyes, your ears, your what? Hands, your feet. To carry them out. Now, Sister Hill tells the scripture, man is tempted when he's drawn away. He's drawn away of his own lust and what? Enticed. Okay. Read that just for a minute.
But every man is tempted when he gets drawn away of his own lust and enticed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, man is tempted. Now watch that. When he's drawn away of his what? See, on the inside of you, you all automatically will have a tendency to gravitate, until your mind is renewed, you have a tendency to gravitate to things that will satisfy, that will pacify, and that will what? Make the flesh happy. I mean, that's a part of your fallen nature. And if you are not doing anything to build yourself up spiritually, when that enticement comes, your feelings and your emotions and your desires are going to, amen, which all emanates in the physical body, they're going to what? They're going to call the shots. They're going to say, yeah, you go in and do that. And they're going to get your members involved. What members are they going to get involved? Your what? Your eyes? What else? Your five senses. That's what flesh means. The five senses. Your hands, your feelings, your ears. Now, let me, okay, they're drawn away of their own lust and enticed, all right? All right, so Satan will try to entice you on the screen of his imaginations when he presents these what? Thoughts. Okay, now some of y'all, he tempts this way. No Bible study for me. On Wednesday night, I'm just going on Sunday alone. And to the devil, he knows if you can keep your mind unrenewed, keep you from the word, it will never be renewed. Sunday morning, like we preach here, like we teach here, is not nearly enough to bring your members in subjection to your human spirit. And when that happens, you know, that's good when it happens, when it brings it in subjection, because your mind will be renewed and your mind will have the ability to what? To counteract or to what? Pull down or to say no, amen, to Satan when he presents that temptation, and your mind will not let your members get involved in whatever enticements or temptation that the enemy is presenting. And what brings you to that point is like the word of God. You got to be under the authority of the fivefold ministry gift. You need that. Now, if you don't come on Wednesday night, I think Brother John can make that available. But I want to hold everybody accountable. If you don't come on Wednesday night, we're trying to work Wednesday. Now, Sunday evening is going good. We got a few people on Sunday evening. Now, it's y'all's responsibility to fit Bible study in your schedule. See, all of these things the devil entices you to do that will distract you and destroy your life and take you downhill is not sinful things. Some of them are what? Good, wholesome things in which you are making, you are putting things before what? God and before your spiritual life. Is that right? And one of the areas of fleshly works is irreverence or putting things before God. Irreverence. The sin of irreverence, just like sexual sin, temperamental sin, people their temperament, they lose their temper, say things, amen, and use their tongue, and the tongue is a member that's the most unruly of all members. And I was going to talk about the tongue this morning because the Bible says it's a world of evil. It's full of deadly what? Poison. And no man can what? Tame the tongue. That's a member. Everybody say, that's a member. So, if you can't tame your tongue, the Bible says if you have improper thoughts, amen, the first thing you ought to do is not speak it out. Don't put your mouth in high gear before you put your mind in first. So we have to learn how to what? We have to what? Learn how to what? Be swift to speak, swift to hear, yes. And what? Slow to speak. Everybody says swift to hear, and what? You need to weigh whatever you're going to say before you speak it. Because once that word goes out, there's no way to retreat. It's going to do its damage when it what? Goes out and be released from your lips. The Bible says that if a man is able to refrain from offending in words, the same as a perfect man. See, a perfect person, a person that's mind renewed, is a person that comes to the place where they don't offend with words. And words are what? Ordered of the Lord, right? And they think through things before they what? Sell. Amen. Some of y'all ought to be saying, praise the Lord, Pastor. I'm glad you... Amen. So, it's full of deadly evil. It's very detrimental in this. The Bible says, I wish we had time to read that. Sister Hill, cut you. Okay, let's finish reading that James one first. What does it say? It first reflects on the screen of your imagination. The devil can't make you do anything until he gets your consent.
Amen.
He has to get your consent. So it's first presented on the screen of your mind, and then you consent. Amen. Whether you will say yes or no depends on the control that you have over your what? Your flesh. Like the members of your what? Body. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Okay, but if your body says, I want to do that, I'm going to try it out. I'm going to take action. I'm going to go to that site. Then you give whatever Satan has written on that screen, you give him what? Consent to invade your life and to get involved in what? In your affairs. You open the door for the devil. Give him an inch! And he'll take 50 miles. Give him an inch. That's all he needs. All he needs is just a little what? A little enroll. Amen. Praise God. We should sing the song, Don't Let the Devil Ride. Because if you let him ride, he's going to want to drive, right? He's going to want to take over. So you have to be able to say what? No. Because if you give the devil consent, he's going to come in and he can what? Wreck your life, work havoc. He can plant all types of seeds and he can get you going on the wrong what? Road. The Bible says there's a way that seemeth right unto a man. The devil will always make you feel like whatever you do is innocent. It's not going to, you know, it's not going to cause no big harm. But there's a way that seemeth right unto a man. But the way thereof is what? The way of death. Amen. Praise God. You got to be, amen, able to resist and say what? No. But if you don't have the word, if you don't have your spiritual life in place, if you're not really, amen, doing basic things you should be doing spiritually, you're not going to be able to what? Resist the devil. The Bible says the devil will flee from you, right? Resist the devil and he will what? Flee. But if before it says he'll flee, you got to what? Submit to God. You got to submit to God first. Everybody says you got to submit to God. Submit to God means what? You submit to all of the disciplines that the Lord told you to do in order for you to be strong enough, amen, to contend with the devil and to carry out whatever God has called you to do. And that's the reason why everybody should be in Bible study reading these books. That's the biggest mistake you're making now. I'm telling y'all. Because the book now is focusing on, being interested in the thing that God is interested in. It's focusing on getting you involved in the number one thing that God is concerned about. Is building the fear of God into your life. How many can say amen?
Amen.
See, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Okay, so when we give in to the things that the devil is presenting, that means that what? If something on the inside of us is craving what? To get something that longing on the inside, what? Fulfill. We want to get what? That thing that is really calling for those desires and amen, those things the enemy is presenting. You want to what? Walk it out. You want that to what? Happen. Or you want to what? Be able to what? Amen. To experience the things that the enemy is trying to what? Present. Amen. So when you begin to take action, when you begin to what? Say, yes, I'm going to what? Use my eyes, I'm going to use my members, I'm going to use my mouth, or whatever. Amen. Then that's the time that it becomes what? Sin. The moment you use your members and get involved in carrying out the will of the enemy or the temptation of the enemy, that's the point that what? Sin's what? Kicks in. It's conceived. Then when sin is conceived, if you just bite the bait, amen, then it becomes what? It becomes sin. Bible says sin, when it is finished, it brings forth what? Brings forth death. Amen. It will bring forth death. 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 See, it's really important for you all to really understand how important it is to what? To have strong spiritual values. It's very important because you could probably in a school of 200 or 300 kids, probably 500 or more, you would be surprised of how many of those kids go to church, ever been in Sunday school, ever read their Bible, who parents are even saved, or take the things of God seriously. So they're fed on a whole lot of garbage and a whole lot of things they have watched, and they're full of what? Corruption. They're full of what? Sin. And if you are hanging around them and feeding on all of that stuff that's coming out of their mouth, and amen, and following the instructions and following the path that they're going and taking, the Bible says there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of what? Death. It's going to lead to what? Death. It's going to lead to what? Death. It's going to lead to actually, praise God, being corrupt, going downhill, and your life gradually is going to begin to be rolled away. You can get so much, you can get so full of this stuff on television and the internet and full of that stuff until your mind is just what? Way out there. You just be meditating on this stuff all the time, trying to figure out what you can do next. Do what my friend say. What is he in? Amen. So that's okay. Let's do a little bit of the time that's in James 2 at the time. This is a member too. Amen. We got to control our members because many times we sin with our tongue. But the Bible says if you have a temptation to get lifted up, the first thing you need to do is put your hand on your mouth. Put your hand on your mouth. Okay, James 3. Okay.
James 3:5.
Okay.
Even so, the tongue
is
a little member
mm-hmm.
and boasts great things.
Mm-hmm. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Just read that second, that third chapter of James, and you can see that, keep on down to the 16th to 17th verse, we don't have a lot of time. But most sin is going to start with what? Words. Everybody said words. I mean, out of all of your members, seeing, hearing, walking, your feet, and all of these members, amen, the tongue does the most damage. Turn to somebody and say, your tongue will do the most damage. And the only way you can what? Keep your tongue in control is that what? It takes what? The word of God. How many of you say it takes the word of God? You can't tame it no other way. Everybody says, you can't tame your tongue no other way. It's going to take the word of God and the what? Spirit of God. And it's going to take you saying what? No. And what? Being slow. Whatever the word tells you to do in regard to handling your tongue, you got to what? Do whatever the word says. Because the Bible says you're snared with the words of your mouth. You're taken captive by the words of your mouth. And the Bible says that the tongue, amen, praise God, if you can't control your tongue, see, where's the scripture that talks about that it will lead to death? I can't remember that scripture. But it's in Proverbs, but I'm going to find it in just a minute because I want you to hear that about the tongue. I have a lot of tongue scriptures here because that's where the problem is. Take somebody and say, that's where the problem is. Yeah, ask the person, are you in control of your tongue? Ask them, are you in control? How many speak a whole lot of negative stuff sometimes? Amen. How many ever hear give negative words coming out of the mouth of saints? Nobody ever heard? The Bible says a fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are the snare of his soul. All right. He that keepeth his mouth keepeth his life, but he that openeth wide his lips shall have destruction. All right, I don't have a scripture here, but I just have it in this book here. But I can give it to you. All of these tongue tamers, if y'all understand tongue tamers, are in the meditation book. How many of you ever seen the tongue tamers? Okay, that's a good one there. All right. All right, I guess I have talked long enough, but the tongue is a deadly member, and the only way we can get control of our tongue is that we have to what? Put it under the power of the Word of God. Is that right? Receive the engrafted Word of God, which is able to what? Save your soul. See, amen. The Word is a big factor. That means Bible study, you need more than on Sunday. Tell somebody you need more than Sunday. I didn't hear nobody know you need more than Sunday. All of these people I have on my list, I have about 25 that haven't even showed up for the first Bible study on Sunday evening, Wednesday night, and none of them. So if you want your mind renewed, it's going to take what? The word, you're going to have to hear me, Brother Williams, and Sister Hill, and Sister Dog, you're going to have to hear a whole lot of folk before you know what? It'll hit home. It's going to take a lot of hearing. That's the reason the Bible says be what? Swift to what? Hear. And slow to what? Speak. Amen. So that is basically the beginning of the teaching on sanctification. It's all about your body and the control of your members. See, we are to separate ourselves from ungodly people. Everybody just said ungodly people. In other words, we're not to deal close relationships with what people that's not what? Saved. People that's not renewed in their minds. I know you have to go to school with them, you have to sit next to them, you have to play with them, you have to be on the same team with them. But I mean that you on the phone with them and listen to all this stuff that they talk about, and their minds what? Is in the gutter? Amen. They're watching people, they do pornography, and what else they do? I mean, everything else. I mean, things which are what? Totally sinful and unwholesome. So you can't Fellowship, the Bible says, have nothing to do with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather what? Reprove them. The Bible, in the doctrine of sanctification, teaches what? Separation. You can't build intimate relations. In other words, times that you don't have to listen to them, you don't have to be with them, you are not to what? Go around and what? Try to, amen, praise God, and fellowship with them, and hang with them. Amen. Praise God. All right. Is that right? All right. Come out from among them and be what? Suffering. That's people that are what? Are not on the same track you are. People that's not going the same direction. That's what sanctification is all about, right? And then it says, amen, praise God, separation from evil influences. Evil influences will be all of the things that will corrupt your mind. It could be what? A whole, a certain, what is that? Music, shows, it's a whole lot of things. Internet, all of these things have evil influences, and the Bible says, amen, that you are to be separate from evil influences. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. And also, you have to separate yourself from people that really use their mouths the wrong way, that speaks negative words, evil words. See, the mouth is the worst one of all. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's full of what? Deadly evil. So therefore, sanctification is actually, the Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed by the what? Renewing of your mind, so that you may what? Demonstrate the thing that is what? Good, that is what? Perfect and acceptable, amen, to the will of God. Amen. Praise God. How many believe that sanctification is important?
Amen.
And the Bible rewards those that are what? Pure. And those that are what? That do things right. Amen. Praise God. How many can say amen? All right. How many? If we would actually really begin to focus on our holiness. Amen. Tell somebody. Let's focus on our holiness.
Focus on
our holiness. All right. A lot of our holiness got so many holes in it until it all went to God. But the Bible says, follow speech with all men, and what? Holiness, without which what? No man shall what? See the Lord. If you get your life together, get in harmony, get your spirit man in control, and saying what? No to all of this fleshly junk that's robbing us of all of our what? Spiritual what? Even energy and power. Holiness. Amen. Let's all stand. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.